I've been absolutely clear with President Putin. He has no misunderstanding of any assembled Russian units move across the Ukrainian border. That is an invasion.
If Russia further invades Ukraine, further uses military aggressive means against Ukraine, there will be white flags.
I say talks between U.S. and Russia begin in the coming hours. The latest effort to resolve the standoff of Ukraine through diplomacy realized in Geneva and Moscow this hour. Well, the damage is extensive and the country's needs are dire. We'll have a live report on the aid that's finally arriving in Tonga after devastating volcanic eruption. And Grammy Award-winning singer Meatloaf will die to look back at his legendary music career.
Live from London, this is CNN Newsroom with Issa Suarez.
Welcome to the show, everyone. It is Friday, January 21st, and we'll begin with a flurry of diplomatic activities scheduled to get underway this hour, aimed really at preventing an all-out war between Russia and Ukraine. Now, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Russian Foreign Minister Sergey Lavrov will meet soon in Geneva, in Switzerland. Negotiations have done little to ease tensions so far, and Ukrainian leaders say the U.S. and President Joe Biden must do more to deter a Russian invasion. Well, tens of thousands of Russian troops are massed on Ukraine's eastern border, and President Biden is having to clean up his comments that a Friday incursion could bring a less forceful response from Western allies.
I've been absolutely clear with President Putin. He has no misunderstanding of any assembled Russian units move across the Ukrainian border, that is an invasion. But in a met a severe and coordinated economic response, Russia will pay a heavy price.
Let's get more than stories. CNN's international diplomatic editor Nick Robertson standing by for us in Moscow. But first, I want to go to Geneva, and our senior international correspondent Fred Lightman, who joins us now. And Fred, the stakes for these talks are huge, and that's probably another statement. But what everyone wants to see is a de-escalation of the tensions. What are the expectations from your vantage point?
Yeah, they want to see de-escalation, and I think they also want to see progress here at these talks and see whether or not progress is actually possible between the U.S. and its allies on the one hand, and then the Russians on the other hand as well. And the fact these talks are happening at all shows that both sides understand how high the stakes are and how important it is to try and keep all this in the diplomatic realm rather than have things get out of control between Ukraine and Russia, with, of course, Russia continuously amassing that force near the borders with Ukraine. And really, it's quite remarkable these talks are taking place in the first place, he said, because remember, after the first round of talks here in Geneva, the Russians afterwards said they were so disappointed they weren't sure whether or not further talks would be possible or whether that or not those could lead to anything. But now, at least, the two top diplomats are talking to one another. And if you look at the areas where things are really difficult, the Russians, of course, put forward the list of demands that they have, where they want written responses from the United States. Secretary of State Blinken has already said those written responses definitely are not coming at this meeting. But the main key places are that the Russians demand that there's no further enlargement of NATO, which obviously first and foremost means no taking into NATO of Ukraine, and that there's no offensive weapons close to Russian borders. And that second point, the U.S. has already signaled that there could be room for negotiations if it's really a big security concern for the Russians. The first point, though, that is going to be the big issue, whether or not some sort of middle ground can be found with that. The U.S. has already said, completely saying that the Ukraine is never going to be a member of NATO. It's simply not going to happen. The Russians are saying that it's a key point for them. Is there any middle ground on that? Or maybe they don't come to some sort of solution on that topic today, but at least they decide to continue to talk to one another. Because one of the things that we have heard from the Russian side over the past, I would say, 12, 14 hours, is that the Kremlin has said they would really like to see another top-level phone conversation, at least, between President Biden and the Russian President Vladimir Putin. Perhaps things could continue in that sphere, and this meeting today could set the stage for that.
Yeah, and the talks ongoing, that's a good sign. Fred, do stay with us. I want to go to Nick. And Nick, President Biden's comments... that. But those initial comments, Nick, caused somewhat of a diplomatic wobble. Is the West, our NATO allies, really united in its response and messaging here in Russia?
Well, there are differences, and Russia certainly was aware of this when it chose to negotiate separately with the United States because it believed it could be a strong influence at NATO, and separately with NATO as a group of nations. The differences are perhaps slightly geographic in terms of perception of the Russian threat. The United States, Canada, the UK, Denmark, Norway, the Baltic states, all feel, you know, that sanctions and measures against Russian actions in Ukraine should be perhaps stronger than some other countries, perhaps some of the southern European nations who are more distant from, you know, the borders of Russia, and who don't feel the threat, the military threat, as much from Russia. So there are differences, and a diplomat at NATO said that, you know, essentially that President Biden shouldn't have really got into airing the fact that there are differences, and those differences perhaps center most on what happens if it's a cyber attack, what happens if it's paramilitary-style, you know, assault from inside Ukraine rather than Russian forces crossing the border initially. What happens if it's something that's sort of orchestrated or triggered in Ukraine that then Russia says that it needs to then send in troops, you know, to support perhaps Russians in the Russian-speaking part of the population in Ukraine. There are all these gray areas, and so those differences have been exposed, do exist, and Russia's certainly aware of those differences, but there is unanimity that if Russia crosses the border with military forces, then that will trigger big sanctions, and we don't know what those economic sanctions precisely would be. But, you know, I think at this stage it is still very much a united front that's being presented by the United States, by NATO, by the European Union, by the principal leaders, that there is, you know, a very clear option to the Kremlin right now. Either you follow the diplomatic path, or there will be a very heavy price to pay, whatever the action. It's just not clear precisely what that price would be. And this is perhaps where the conversation between Lavrov and Blinken can go today, and certainly will be the center of, you know, how the Kremlin assesses the situation at the moment.
And we should be keeping an eye on that when it gets underway. Important perspective there. Fred Blackman in Geneva. Thank you. Now, the U.S. House Committee investigating the attack on the Capitol a year ago is zeroing in on a new witness, the former president's daughter, who witnesses say tried to reason with him during the speech. Now, the committee released its letter to Ivanka Trump Thursday, asking for her voluntary cooperation with their investigation. CNN's Paula Reed has the story, please.
The House Select Committee investigating January 6th, moving in on former President Trump's inner circle, requesting a voluntary interview from Ivanka Trump.
I'm very proud of you.
The committee has already gathered some evidence about what the former first daughter was doing on the day of the insurrection.
In first-hand testimony, that his daughter Ivanka went in at least twice to ask him to please stop this violence.
In an 8-page letter today, the committee said it would like to discuss any other conversations you may have witnessed or participated in regarding the president's plan to obstruct or impede the counting of electoral votes. Lawmakers also want to know more about what she saw in the Oval Office, saying a witness has testified that she was there for a call between her father and the vice president when Trump tried to pressure Mike Pence to go along with a plan to block the certification of electoral votes. They also want to know why she didn't do more. Testimony obtained by the committee indicates that members of the White House staff requested your assistance on multiple occasions to intervene in an attempt to persuade President Trump to address the ongoing lawlessness and violence on Capitol Hill. And they also want to ask her whether her father gave any orders to deploy the National Guard that day. The committee is aware that certain White House staff devoted time during the violent riot to rebutting questions regarding whether the president was attempting state of mind a key focus of the committee. Their letter painting a picture of a chaotic White House and staffers hoping that Ivanka, a senior advisor, could get through to her father. They also want to talk to Ivanka about how others, including Fox News host Sean Hannity, tried to stop Trump from talking about the election being stolen and keep him away from certain people. Ivanka's representative issued a statement saying, as the committee already knows, Ivanka did not speak at the January 6th rally, as she publicly stated that day at 3:15 p.m., any security breach or disrespect to our law enforcement is unacceptable. The violence must stop immediately. Please be peaceful. It did not say whether she will comply with the committee's request.
I have to find 12,000 votes, and I have them times a lot, and therefore I won the state.
The former president's efforts to overturn the 2020 election also under scrutiny in Georgia today, where the Fulton County District Attorney is requesting a special grand jury to gather evidence and compel witnesses. The DA, Fannie Willis, saying her office has information indicating possible criminal disruption of that state's election process. The House committee is also looking into whether there was involvement from the Trump White House in the creation or submission of fake electors.
He and his allies coordinated the nuts and bolts process of creating fake electors on a state-by-state level. Now, one illegitimate elector from Michigan boasted at a recent Republican event that the Trump campaign directed the entire operation. We are for and the seven state sources say were targeted in the fake elector scheme were all states Trump lost, as you can see there on the screen, namely Georgia and Arizona, both longtime red states that turned blue in 2020. Well, while U.S. House lawmakers continue to piece together the events leading up to the January 6th insurrection, U.S. President Joe Biden is looking ahead at a landmark legislation he still hopes to get through Congress this year. The key Democratic senator who stalled Mr. Biden's $2 trillion bill back better bill is indicating he's in no hurry. Joe Manchin told CNN, quote, I'm open to start with a clean sheet of paper. We'll just be started from scratch whenever we start on that. That's a severe blow to the White House, of course, which spent months trying to craft a spending bill that Manchin could support. U.S. Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg says the legislation is too important to give up. He spoke earlier to CNN.
We know that these are good policies that the American people correctly believe are going to make them better off. Whether we're talking about fighting inflation, lowering the cost of insulin, lowering the cost of being in the workforce by giving people child care that they can afford, giving people pre-K child tax credit, the things we have to do for our climate, you name it. But these are really important policies that are going to make Americans better off, help deal with the fact that there's a lot of upward pressure on prices right now. And for that reason, we continue to believe they're going to pass. What form it's in, what legislative vehicle it's in, the ups and downs and twists and turns on Capitol Hill, that's going to continue to, I'm sure, be a long, drawn-out story. But at the end of the day, you know, these are good policies that have to get done. We're going to keep pushing them.
Well, with the 2022 midterm elections now less than 10 months away, President Biden said he was disappointed that voting rights legislation failed to pass Congress on Wednesday. But when he was asked if that failure might delegitimize the upcoming elections, his answer took many people by surprise. And here's what he said.
I'm not saying it's going to be legitimate. It's the increase in the prospect of being illegitimate is a direct proportion of not being able to get these reforms passed.
While the dust-up over that remark prompted the White House to spend much of Thursday trying to explain what the president really meant to say.
He was not trying to predict that the 2022 election would not be legitimate. Quite the opposite. His view, and he's told us this privately a lot, is that in 2020, the American people rose to the moment. We had COVID. People were trying to suppress the vote. They still turned out in record numbers. What we also, though, need to be clear-eyed about, and this is what he was trying to convey last night, is that there were efforts in 2020 by the former president and his supporters to attempt to overturn the outcome of the election. We need to be clear-eyed about that possibility or about the effort to try to do that. We need to educate voters. We need to make sure they know what their rights are. And that's what our focus is going to be on moving forward.
White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki speaking earlier. Now, for some, sad breaking news to be the foul, the American rock star and Grammy winner known as Meat Loaf.
I wasn't a big fan of his music, but I liked him on the Apprentice TV show.
Famous for 1970s hits, Paradise, By the Dashboard Light, and you took the words right out of my mouth, his That Out of Hell, I remember very clearly, remains one of the best-selling rock albums of all time. Family wrote on Facebook that they were with Meat Loaf, his real name was Michael Ebrea, during his final hours, and that their hearts are broken. CNN's Paul Buchanan has a look back at his life.
Meat Loaf performs sweet suburban melodies with dramatic flair, unleashing the lyrics of composer Jim Steinman.
I go out on a stage as if it's the last thing I'll ever do. I will, and that's what I've always said. If I'm going out on the stage.
Meat Loaf, where did that name come from?
The real story is that there is no story. The real story is that kids. I was about 8 years old. I've been called Meat Loaf since I was about eight.
Meat Loaf, or Meat for short, was born Michael Lee Day in Dallas, Texas. But even Texas was not big enough to corral his talents. Meat Loaf would go on to sell more than 80 million records worldwide. One of the top-selling musicians ever. His three Battle of Hell albums became staples in college dorms. The first one selling 43 million copies.
Battle Hell 1, I was not ready for it. I had a nervous breakdown. I went to a psychologist and psychiatrist for 2 years, and I went with him to deal with the word star.
Meat got a hold of his demons. He starred on stage and screen of Rocky Horror Picture Show. And Bob Paulson, Fight Club.
The first rule is, I'm not supposed to talk about it. And the second rule is, I'm not supposed to talk about it. And the third rule is, I'm a member.
Off screen, he married twice, became a father to two daughters. And Meat Loaf entered reality TV, Donald Trump's Celebrity Apprentice.
That's insane.
In an infamous episode, he blistered Gary Busey.
That was crazy.
You look in my eyes, I am the last person in the world you ever want to win. Such harsh yelling in stark contrast to what launched Meat Loaf to international adoration, that operatic voice.
Yeah, he was out of control. He was cool.
Meat Loaf. Cause of death has not yet been released. Meat Loaf was 74.
Meat Loaf.
Does sinus congestion and pressure make breathing?
We have a big lineup for you on this Friday morning. Eddie Scary, Joe Concha, Rachel Campbell Stubby is joining us with the stars of the hit TV show Duck Dynasty. Lara Trump also here. Don't miss a minute.
Why do nearly 1 million businesses choose stamps.com to mail?
Commercials.
Thank you.
administration is tightening U.S. borders in hopes of curbing the spread of COVID-19. Beginning on Saturday, essential travelers arriving in the U.S. by land or ferry must be fully vaccinated, and they'll have to show proof. The rule will not apply to U.S. citizens and permanent residents. Now, according to data from Johns Hopkins University, the U.S. has reported a total of 69 million COVID cases since the start of the pandemic. That's more than a quarter of those infections have now been reported just in this past month during, of course, the Omicron surge.
Florida and Georgia are down, and California's down.
Right around the world.
Most of the central other states are all up. A few of the northeastern states are down.
The passed law on Thursday, making it compulsory for residents over 18. Now, the mandate will be enforced beginning March 15th.
Austria mandates vaccines for adults, France began easing restrictions in February, China and COVID
for the COVID-19 restrictions. Sports and cultural venues will be allowed to be open February 2nd. Then later in the month, nightclubs, concerts and bars will follow suit. And just with just 2 weeks to go really until the start of the Winter Olympics, Olympic officials say COVID has been detected among the guests who have already arrived in Beijing. But they have stressed that no infection has occurred in the closed loop, which includes the village and venues. Well, CNN has more COVID headlines covered around the world. Jim Vitamin is in Paris, the latest on the lifting of restrictions in France. But first, let me go to Christy Stout in Hong Kong with more on those COVID cases ahead of the Winter Olympics. And Christy, these new cases will be of concern, no doubt, to authorities as we prepare now for the Olympics in 2 weeks.
Yeah, and it was just a matter of fact that these would be detected. Look, it's just 2 weeks to go before the start of the Beijing Winter Games, and cases of COVID-19 have been detected in recent arrivals heading into Beijing for the Games. We got a statement from the IOC, and the organizers tell us this, quote, the positivity of arrivals testing is 1.53%, for regular screening testing inside the closed loop, 0.02%. The IOC adds and emphasizes there is no infection inside the closed loop. I've known nearly 11,000 people, we're talking about athletes, officials, volunteers, media, they're all set to arrive in Beijing for the Winter Games. The closed loop system that we've been reporting about for the last 2 weeks, that is up and running. It covers all stadiums, venues, accommodation, and to get into the closed loop system, all arrivals have to test negative twice before flying into Beijing. All athletes and participants, they have to stay inside the bubble and undergo daily COVID-19 testing. Fully vaccinated participants, they can enter the closed loop without quarantine. If you're not vaccinated, you have to go to 21 days of quarantine once you touch down in Beijing. And about whether or not you test positive for COVID, as we talked about before, if you test positive, you cannot compete, you cannot take part. If you are symptomatic, you have to stay in a designated hospital for treatment. Asymptomatic, you go to isolation. But whether or not that's inside the loop, we don't know about that just yet.
Very strict rules all around. So we could say let's go to Jim in Paris. And Jim, restrictions are easing, welcome news, no doubt, so many. But I remember you and I were talking earlier in the week where we were talking about cases soaring.
Absolutely. And in fact, they're easing the restrictions here despite the fact that the cases each day have been coming in around 400,000 or so. New cases each day, each 24 hour period. They're also despite the fact that something like 19,000 classrooms in this country, school classrooms, remain closed because of COVID. But the Prime Minister announced last night this easing of restrictions that you mentioned earlier, which includes an end to mask wearing in public areas starting on the 2nd of February, also on the 2nd of February. Employers will no longer be mandated to have their workers working from home, but they're going to be, still remain a recommendation to government. And the reason behind the government's decision on this easing of restrictions basically is based on the fact that there are two things happening. The vaccine pass is going to come into effect on Monday. That's given the fact that the constitutional court will clear it today. It still hasn't happened yet today, but we're expecting it to happen soon. And then the second thing is that the number of people in ICU beds has stabilized over the last week or so. And because of that, they're looking at these studies and saying, well, maybe we can do something. Lisa?
Jim Vitamin for us in Paris, with Sarah and Christy Stout in Hong Kong. Thank you very much. And still to come, right here on CNN News, and countries rushed to deliver aid to Tonga following dual disasters. Blake?
aid is finally arriving in Tonga 6 days after that massive and deadly volcano. I'll have the latest on the recovery efforts as aid begins to trickle in.
Right about now, we can all use a pancake, a nice burger, a nice burrito, an IHOP.
I haven't used the slide in a while.
If you're just joining us, let me bring you up to date with our top story this hour. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov are in Geneva, Switzerland for a new round of talks. Tens of thousands of Russian troops are massed on the border with Ukraine, with more on the way to neighboring Belarus. Ukraine fears an attack and a possible repeat of Moscow's 2014 annexation of Crimea. And in the United States, the House Select Committee investigating the Capitol insurrection officially requested a meeting with Ivanka Trump. Committee members say they have first-hand testimony that the former first daughter was at the White House on January 6th and asked her father at least twice to stop the violent riot. We'll have, of course, much more on both those stories in the coming hours. Now, more than 10 million people in the eastern United States are currently under winter weather alert. Coastal parts of Virginia and the Carolinas are set to experience a rare snow and ice event. The governors of those three states have issued states of emergency in preparation for the weather to come. Keeping an eye on this is Derek Van Dam joins us now. And Derek, what advice have people been being given as they prepare for this ice storm?
You know, quite frankly, he said what people can do is to help themselves, is to stay off the road, to help also the authorities out there. So you're not getting the taxes and having to call authorities to come and rescue you. The ice storm will get worse progressively through the course of the day, right along the coastal areas of the Carolinas, and that is where we have our winter storm warnings and ice storm warnings in place. It's all part of a larger storm system that stretches from the coastal areas of the Carolinas through the deep south, and it's even bringing a rain-snow mixture through southern Texas and even into Louisiana. Look at this storm intensifying through the course of the day today. You can see that shading of pink indicating that rain, snow, freezing rain that we're anticipating. It will see temperatures drop behind it drastically, and our temperatures will crash behind it. So we'll end this event with snowfall, a rare snowfall, I should note, for some of the coastal areas of the Carolinas, so Myrtle Beach to Charleston. Start to see a few snowflakes fly by Saturday morning. But here's the latest thinking from the National Weather Service. You can see the ice storm warning in and around Wilmington and the New Bern region. That shading of purple indicates the ice storm warning. Shades of pink to the north, that's a winter storm warning where we anticipate anywhere from 4 to upwards of 6 inches of snow. Here's the evolution of the storm through the course of the day today. You can see how the cold front crashes through, brings in our colder temperatures behind it. We transition that ice over to snow, so that's only going to make travel more treacherous as the day ends.
You're showing a snow line that looks like it's about, I don't know, 50 miles west of Charlotte.
In and around Wilmington, as you
going diagonally, coming
around the coastal portions of South Carolina, but it will remain snow for places like Norfolk and to the extreme southeastern sections of Virginia. This is the broader picture. Again, it's all part of a storm system that's bringing a Texas-sized cool down to the Lone Star State, where temperatures there, get this, Issa, have dropped 39 degrees Fahrenheit in Houston, Texas, in about a 24-hour period behind this cold front. And that is why we have some freezing rain taking place across the southern portions of Texas.
Stay safe, everyone. Appreciate it. Derek Van Damme there. Thank you, Derek.
Right.
Now, we now want to take you to Tonga, a nation that took a devastating hit from a volcano eruption and tsunami. Now, this is what many Tongans see across their country now. Their sources of drinking water are polluted, and much of their agricultural wealth is wiped out. But several countries are rushing aid to Tonga, including desperately needed water, while international phone service, which was knocked out by the eruption, slowly coming back online. Blake Hester is monitoring developments and joins me now from Tokyo. And Blake, I mean, we've now, day six since that first of that eruption. Talk us through where things stand on that recovery effort.
One of the big things to develop today is that the main communication lines for the island nation, which are still a few weeks away from being restored, there is some good news on that front. International call service has been partially restored for two islands, including Tonga's main island of Tonga Tapu. This service
can
support about 400 calls.
The phone has been cut off, and then the water cable.
Great news, but Tonga is made up
broke, it needs to be repaired. Peru looks really messed up too.
About 36 of those islands.
The tsunami caused
the
majority of
the
population in Peru.
Live on the island where cell phone service was partially restored. There are still tens of thousands of people still unable to communicate with the outside world. Although communication remains a problem for the time being because of ash contamination, a shortage of drinking water, and food.
The Tonga is full of ash.
The big problem
it's so
here
disgusting.
For those
I saw the before and after pictures.
The food insecurity as well as water insecurity.
It looked like mud. First of all, it was mud from the tsunami that
now, starting
the
Thursday,
water
international aid began to arrive.
And I realized it was actually
the airport was cleared of ash. That includes planes filled with humanitarian aid, water, and other supplies which start to arrive from New Zealand and Australia. A Royal Navy ship.
Yeah, Australian ship. Australia ships some things. It would take like 3 days to get there, they said.
A desalination plant that can actually produce about 70,000 liters of fresh water daily. Arriving soon, Japan is flying in two planes worth about 500 tons of bottled water. The UK is also sending a Royal Navy ship from Tahiti filled with water and medical supplies. And Australia has sent a naval ship expected to arrive next week. That ship will not only be carrying humanitarian aid and medical supplies, but also four helicopters and small boats to help distribute supplies to those outer islands. Lisa?
Blake Essex, we're up there in Tokyo. Thanks very much, Blake. Good to see you. Now, earlier we spoke to the Pacific Health head of programming for the International Federation of Red Cross, and we asked her how much of a difference the aid delivered so far has made.
With the resources that we've been able to mobilize with the Australian Red Cross and the New Zealand Red Cross, and they have been supported by the government. We've got a ship that's on its way to Tonga. We've got water containers, tarpaulins, solar lanterns, and shelter kits, which will be all part of what the team will be distributing on the island. So we have, currently we have enough supplies that they're able to distribute, and this would be to replenish what they actually distributed.
Well, for more information on how you can help the people of Tonga, please visit our webpage at cnn.com/.
Wow.
Now, Peruvian president is declaring a climate emergency after a massive oil spill caused by the same underwater volcano eruption and tsunami. Officials say about 6,000 barrels spilled into the
sea. I don't think they really had time to get evacuated either.
River triggered, in fact, by that eruption. Teams are still trying to
contain the oil.
The president called it the most worrying ecological disaster on the Peruvian coast.
I saw some flooding on Big Island in Hawaii, too.
Not shy away from.
It was on the Kailua Kona side, the leeward side. I'm sorry, the leeward side. The west side, the leeward side of Kailua Kona. This business was totally overflowed with water, and this lady was gone, and she didn't know what happened, so she came back. And it did like over $100,000 of damage.
Selling a home is expensive and stressful.
More commercials. Stations keep doing a lot of commercials and a lot of commercials at the same time.
She manages to get the passenger out of the partially open driver's side door as more officers arrive to
assist in the crash. Under
investigation, thankfully, all involved were not seriously injured.
Todd, 13 U.S. service members lost their lives in a suicide bombing during the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. But President Biden says he has no regrets.
There is no way to be out of Afghanistan after 20 years easily. Not possibly, no matter when you did it. And I make no apologies for it again.
Joining me now, Royce McCollum, sister of Marine Lance Corporal Riley McCollum, who was killed in the August 26th attack on the Kabul airport, and Dennis Postiglione, attorney for the McCollum family. Good morning to you both. It's great to have you on. Royce, when you heard the president say that during his press conference, that he makes no apologies for the botched Afghanistan withdrawal, what went through your head?
Very upset. He still has not mentioned them by name once. And, you know, he takes zero responsibility for anything that happened there, even though it was his call, which is very unfortunate.
Yeah, and, you know, Royce, he said that he has great concern for the people who die, but his answer seemed also very dismissive. Your family met with the president.
They should do
after
a special memorial for these soldiers because they're the last Americans to die there. A lot of Americans died in the war in Afghanistan.
My sister and my sister-in-law both stayed, and he couldn't even mention. Again, my brother's name, had no idea who he was talking to when he addressed her and spoke about his son instead. Very just unapologetic again, and about himself. He still has not owned to or admitted anything that he's done wrong.
I sure have missed anything.
Well, tell us about your brother, because many of Fox News viewers do know his name because of his bravery and his sacrifice.
Really,
what was he like as a brother?
Me and him constantly fought. We were the best siblings. You know, we're siblings, but, you know, we always had each other's backs and we're always there for each other. He started wrestling at 5 years old, and I spent every single weekend with him, every day after school practicing with him. We were together all the time, which is why we fought so much. He was a hero, he was a patriot, and we actually just spoke with our juggler and our kickboxer yesterday, and got the full autopsy report. So everything that we got happened was just confirmed yesterday with the investigation. He was doing what he wanted to be doing. He wanted to be a Marine his whole life, and he died doing what he wanted to be doing.
How has the last year been for you and your family?
Rough. We weren't able to see him for about 8-9 months before he died, just with him being stationed.
In Wakeford, if you remember, that's the member of parliament that defected as we literally crossed the aisle and joined the opposition, saying that he was threatened with funding being withheld for schools in his town. So very
talking
serious
about
allegations here, and again, that senior member of parliament, William Rao, telling any MPs who feel threatened, intimidated, he said this amounted to blackmail, to report that to the Speaker of the House of Commons, and even to the police here at the ESA. So very serious here. Prime Minister Boris Johnson has, for his part, denied this himself, denied these allegations himself, and said he's seen no evidence of this alleged blackmail. But let's take a step back. From the he said, she said of the situation, because the reality is that the Conservative Party is absolutely at a crossroads here. They need to decide what they're going to do with their star candidate, Boris Johnson, right? The man who was able to galvanize the Tory heartland, the man who was able to get people to vote Conservative who had never voted before. Quite simply, his support is based on the fact that Prime Minister Boris Johnson does so well at the polls. He is a successful politician in that sense. But that popularity is quickly waning. You're looking at a prime minister now who has the lowest approval rating since he took office. We're now seeing the Conservative Party, which had been ahead of Labour, trailing behind the opposition Labour Party in local polling. We interviewed one MP earlier this week who was telling us that he received hundreds of correspondences from angry voters, people frustrated that the government isn't following the rules. What I'm trying to paint here is a picture of MPs who are worried about their own seat in Parliament, about whether or not they're going to win next time that they're up for ballot, right? So if that continues to happen, if more MPs continue to turn against Prime Minister Boris Johnson, no longer see him as that success story that's going to help them at the ballot box, that's when you can see a no confidence vote triggered. And the key number there, of course, 15% of conservative lawmakers. If they submit those letters, that no confidence vote could happen.
Yeah, and constituents have been very vocal about the crisis that has unfolded all the parties at Downing Street, because Nile and their family fellows, who's there for us, thanks so much, Nile. Now, a report from German investigation finds that former Pope Benedict XVI failed to act or claim to child abuse when he was Archbishop of Munich. Now, the inquiry was conducted by a local law firm, allegations going back decades. Hundreds of victims were found, and a few cases were reported while the Pope Benedict was Munich's Archbishop, then known as Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger.
In a total of 4 cases, we have come to the conclusion that then Archbishop Cardinal Ratzinger can be accused of misconduct in cases of sexual abuse. 2 of these cases concern acts of abuse committed during his tenure and sanctioned by the state.
Not Benedict, because he's been stepped down as Pope since 2013 for his tenure, was overshadowed by a growing scandal of allegations of sexual abuse of minors. CNN Vatican correspondent Dina Gallagher has more on the report and the response so far.
This is a massive report running more than 1,800 pages, covering about a 75-year time period from 1945 to 2019, looking at cases of sexual abuse in the Archdiocese of Munich. It was just released on Thursday afternoon, and the initial responses from the Vatican and from Pope Emeritus Benedict say they need time to read it and look into the findings. Cardinal Marx, who is the current Archbishop of Munich, is also implicated in the report for mishandling two cases of sexual abuse during his tenure. He is a close advisor to Pope Francis. He also gave a brief statement to the press on Thursday saying he would need time to read the report, and he will be holding a press conference next Thursday to discuss it. This report was commissioned by the Catholic Church in Munich. It was part of their historical reckoning, part of their way of holding themselves accountable for what happened in the past. Reports like this have been going on in dioceses throughout the world as part of the Catholic Church's effort at transparency. This report, of course, all the more important because it does include the years in which the Pope Emeritus was Archbishop of Munich from 1977 to 1982. So now it is up to the Vatican to respond to these findings. We'll see what they have to say in the coming days. Delia Gallagher, CNN. Right.
Thank you, Delia. Now, at least 17 people have died and dozens more are injured after a huge explosion in western Ghana on Thursday. Officials say it happened when a truck carrying explosives for the mining operations collided with a motorcycle. The blast appears to have completely leveled one town in western Ghana, trapping people and animals in the rubble underneath collapsed buildings. We say most of them have now been rescued and sent to Gatwick Hospital. At least 29 people have been killed during a stampede in Liberia, and with others in critical condition, it's clear that the number will rise. This was the scene outside the hospital earlier. The tragedy unfolded during a church gathering in Monrovia. There were reports of robbers rushed crowds, boarding the crush of people. The government has declared 3 days of national mourning. One survivor explained what she was doing.
Because of the crowd, I told my big sister. I said, I'm feeling bad. Let's go home. Me and my sister were coming. And as soon as we reached the gate, that's when we saw a big crowd. People pushing each other, falling down. That's when I told my sister, let's go back, but we couldn't. They'd already closed the gate. By then we were outside, couldn't go back inside, and people died. People were stepping on my back, my chest. I fainted, and by the time I came to, I was in the hospital.
That investigation into the
was inside airborne? Blast of immune support. That's the only shot of vitamin C to keep an aircraft.
Right, some of it.
Commercials, both stations, commercials, okay. All right, well, I'm going to call it quits for now. Take it easy.